The following production has been made in cooperation with the Montgomery College Smithsonian Faculty Fellowship Program, providing MC students with theme-based learning through a unique partnership between the Paul Peck Humanities Institute at Montgomery College and the Smithsonian Center for Learning and Digital Access.
As part of the Smithsonian Faculty Fellowship Program, Montgomery College Chemistry Professor Dr. Virginia Miller took her class to the Stephen F. Udvar-Hazy Center. The class examined American innovation and enterprise. In this case, it was studying the chemistry utilized in developing spacesuits and thermal heat shields. And who better to learn it from than two Smithsonian curators? The first stop was along one of the walls of the Boeing Aviation Hangar, where the class came upon a collection of pressure suits, precursors to NASA's spacesuits. As Smithsonian curator Dr. Cathleen Lewis explained, they were designed to be used on Earth to test equipment while being sealed in vacuum chambers.
This goes back to a period during the 1950s when the United States Air Force was still running bulbs instead of transistors in their aircraft. And they had a very high failure rate, and it wasn't acceptable. It was 1950s before the innovation of transistors and the integration of transistors into electronic technologies. And the way they had to test their tubes was in a vacuum chamber, because an airplane during the 1950s was taking a lot of G-forces, was going up into the high atmosphere, in the stratosphere, coming down very quickly, and they couldn't afford to have those tubes explode. This suit was built by the Litton Corporation. When you're building for a vacuum chamber, you don't have to worry about weight and clumsiness. You just will need a suit that is strong and will withstand repeated sealings and reuse. So what Litton had worked on is having a composite material hard suit with these accordion type joints, so they could maintain a constant volume even when the technician or the pilot ultimately moved their arms. NASA went from Litton making the suits for them, and they transferred the activity to Ames Research Center in California. And thus the name changed, of the nomenclature of the suits changed from the RX suits to the AX suits, A for Ames. They've gone from these spring-loaded joints to these conical joints. Those conical joints under pressure would operate within about 90% of the range of motion of a human joint. There's one small drawback on these conical joints. Because they're operating under such a high pressure, they had a propensity to blow back. So suddenly, if you moved on one side, your arm may be swinging uncontrollably back into its original position. This is the toaster suit. Look at the shoulders. They're very wide. The Apollo spacecraft is like sitting in the front seat in a Mini Cooper with your two best friends. Once they inflated that for tests, the guy in the middle seat popped up like a piece of toast. There just was not enough room. Bubble helmets that have very wide field of vision, because if you're going to be exploring and walking on another surface of another world, you want to be able to look down, you want to be able to bend over, and you certainly want to be able to see your feet. You have to see your feet in order to walk and not stumble.
As they transitioned from pressure suits, Dr. Lewis took the students over to the James S. McDonald Space Hangar, where the suits looked a little more familiar.
Jim Irwin wore this suit into space on the surface of the moon. This is the difference between the theoretical, what they were doing and experimenting with new technologies and trying to invent new technologies, and what they landed with. You'll notice the shoulders are narrower. The shoulders are made with a rubber convolute, which is sort of like the drainage convolutes that you have on your houses, the draw away water, and they're bend and they're flexible. Well, that's essentially what the rubber convolute is. The suit was modified after Apollo 14 for the lunar rover missions. The interesting things are the materials. One of the stipulations in the contract with ILC or with any other contractor at this time, they were on a timetable. They had to complete the mission to send a man to the moon and bring him back safely by the end of the decade. They had to use existing materials, and that was a requirement stipulated in the NASA contract. They could not innovate on the materials. ILC Industries at the time, as they were known, had to rely on materials that were coming out of chemical companies, and probably the most famous was the DuPont Company. They've been making munitions for the United States since the 19th century. At the end of World War II, they decided that they were going to catch on to this flood of suburban life and suburban living, the flourishing of home ownership, the post-World War II home ownership boom, and they were going to make domestic materials and domestic textiles. And these were all materials that were developed by DuPont. They were developed for home furnishings, and in fact, they were marketed for home furnishings. When I was growing up, my parents had fiberglass curtains. They were the newest, latest thing. They weren't flammable. They were one of the marvels of the 1960s to have fiberglass curtains. You had these new materials that were low care. One thing they knew about fiberglass is that it breaks apart rather quickly. That's why it's okay for curtains. You take it from the factory, you hang it on your curtain rod. But if you're going to have a human being moving around in it, those fibers are going to break up. So they had to modify the fiberglass fabric. And what they did was they dipped each fiber into Teflon. That made it easier to weave, and more importantly, that made it easy to sew. It was the tradition in the Apollo program that the astronauts would get their patches as a reward. So the patches you see on this suit were replaced after flight. Now, if you look at it very closely, you can see the stitch marks, especially if you're a sewer. You can see where it's been replaced and put in place. Now you see the suit is dirty. That is lunar dust. On the inside is what I've referred to as the pressure layer. And that is a nylon fabric that is dipped in a latex. And that is what keeps the air inside. And that is the protective. That's what keeps the astronaut alive. These other layers are very light and fluffy and don't seem to do much. But these are what really protect the astronaut's life out in the vacuum of space and the harsh climate of space. These layers are what protect the astronaut from the micrometeors or the particles flying in space. They had to engineer protection for particles traveling up to 18,000 miles an hour. A particle would go through a top layer, could penetrate the beta cloth, but then it would break up. And as it went through the subsequent layers, the particle would break up, lose kinetic energy, and dissipate and be somewhere embedded in the inner layers, but never penetrate that also important bladder layer. Both the Russians and the Americans and everyone worldwide realized that rubber was the way to go to provide an airtight barrier to hold oxygen inside. This is, once again, a rubber dipped cloth, not so synthetic. It's a cotton poly mix of cloth with rubber on one side. It is not a synthetic rubber. The Russians used natural rubbers up until the 1970s for their space program. And what the cosmonaut does is climb into the spacesuit, and he has this large bladder sticking out, and he has a built-in seal, and he wraps it around. It's just like a trash bag. And he pulls it tight. And then when he presses it in and zips up his spacesuit, when the spacesuit is pressurized, this presses together between his body and the spacesuit, which forms a restraint system, and it forms a seal. They've been using this since the 1930s for 80 years.
They're still using it?
They still use that pressure. The so-called suits, when you see the astronauts and cosmonauts preparing for launch on board the Soyuz and Baikonur, they're wearing a so-called spacesuit, and that is how it's sealed.
Within the space hangar sits a large, unavoidable artifact, the Space Shuttle Discovery. To tell its story was curator Dr. Valerie Neal.
You're too young to remember this, but I'm not. In the 1960s and 1970s, we flew astronauts in capsules, very small spacecraft that were not much larger than the inside of an automobile. They were one-time-only craft. They came plummeting back into the Earth's atmosphere from space on a ballistic trajectory, and they had a heat shield on the bottom that gradually sublimated and kind of charred away or evaporated away. And after the spacecraft had been through that launch and return scenario, it couldn't be used again. They were one-time only spacecraft. For the shuttle era, NASA wanted to do something entirely different. And the idea was to build a very versatile spacecraft to operate in Earth orbit and to be used again and again and again, much like an airplane. So this clearly was inspired by aircraft design. Most people are surprised at how large it is. It's the size basically of a 737 aircraft or a DC-9. And it is a hybrid vehicle because it serves as a rocket during launch, a spacecraft in orbit, and a glider during return and re-entry. It doesn't have a powered descent. It's simply gliding. So the crew has one time and one time only to get back safely. From here forward to just ahead of the windshield, the windows there, is the crew cabin area. That's where the crew live and work while they're in orbit wearing normal clothes. I've heard crews describe it as being about the size of two minivans stacked on top of each other. This whole area is the payload bay or the cargo bay. This is why there is such a huge spacecraft, because NASA and the Department of Defense wanted to be able to take really big payloads into orbit. And then you come to this part from the end of the payload bay back. That is all the propulsion system, the main propulsion system, and the orbital maneuvering system. You'll see up here on the front, there are some ovals and circles that are cut out. That is the reaction control system, forward reaction control system, and then there's more in the aft. And those are small engines that are used for roll and pitch and yaw once it's in orbit to change the attitude of the vehicle. The Ohms engines are used in orbit to raise and lower the altitude or to go a long distance laterally in orbit, like to catch up with the International Space Station. Anything that goes to orbit and comes back is going to slam back into the atmosphere and generate heat as it essentially rubs up against the stray molecules and atoms that are up there. Space is not truly a vacuum. The heat that is being generated past this vehicle is up to about 2300 degrees Fahrenheit. So how do you protect that aluminum vehicle body from getting soft and melting eventually? And you do it by putting a heat shield all over it. In the early days, the heat shield was really only needed on the bottom of these bell-shaped capsules because they came into the atmosphere bottom down. This was going to come back into the atmosphere because of its shape, nose high, and the whole bottom exposed. And so the bottom of this was designed to be the primary heat shield, but heat was going to flow up around the sides and over the top of the vehicle as well. So you had to cover the entire thing. And they came up with an idea that was really in its infancy, and that was to try working with ceramic tiles, because ceramic tiles, made of the right material, could be lightweight, but also have very good heat rejection properties. They had mapped this entire vehicle, and you can see it has a great variety of shapes and geometries in it. So they had mapped it and specified the dimensions of every single tile, up to about 24,000 tiles, each one distinctive for its place on the vehicle. So think of this as a 24,000 piece jigsaw puzzle, and each tile only has one place to go. And you can see they vary in thickness, they vary in shape, they all have a unique serial number stamped on them, which shows where on the orbiter it goes, it matched to a map. The tile people would take these big slabs of the tile material and computer program the lathe to cut shapes to the exact dimensions needed. And then those shapes had a sealant put on them and they were baked out. And then they had the top coating put on. And this is a glass coating, as you can see, very thin and it's very brittle. It's easy to damage it. But this is a borosilicate glass that is put on the black tiles, black to radiate heat, not to absorb, but to radiate heat. Very little heat gets through the borosilicate glass, but what does travels very, very slowly inside because this is all air and a little bit of silica. You'll see that they all have a little circular target in the center of them. Remember, I said these are like 98% air. The glass coating protects that volume of air inside, but the orbiter would sit out on the launch pad for sometimes weeks and weeks in the Florida humidity, afternoon showers. You know, they would roll it back in if a hurricane was coming through, but it's very moist down there. So anything that's mostly air is porous. And so they learned that they needed to waterproof the tiles. And so those circles on each tile, those are targets for injecting waterproofing material into the tile to prevent moisture from sort of seeping into the tiles. And they had to be waterproof after every couple of missions. You'll also notice the different shades of these. This is a newer tile. It's glossier and black. And these are older tiles that haven't been replaced. This one may have been damaged in flight or on the ground, so it was replaced. So out of all these 24,000 tiles or so on the vehicle, about 18,000 of them are still original. So there's where you get your reusability. And by having them in individual pieces, if one is damaged, you don't have to deal with the whole heat shield. You just fix the damaged place. There aren't a lot of white tiles anymore. There are still some up there on the OMS pod you can see. Over the years, they were replaced with quilts and blankets, and you can see they're kind of smooth. These also are easily replaced if they need to be. They're made out of silica. Again, silica fibers that have been made into a fabric and multiple layers of that fabric, and then stitched with a very durable fabric on the outside. The thread is actually quartz, spun quartz threads. The part of the heat shield that gets the very hottest is right here on the leading edge of the wings and on the nose cap. And you'll notice that they look very different, and they are not made of silica tiles. This is actually more like a fiberglass material. It's built up from layers of a fiber cloth that is a carbon cloth, and it too is baked out twice to essentially burn out of it anything that's burnable, so that what you have left is a carbon shield that can't burn anymore. It's called reinforced carbon-carbon. For the Columbia tragedy that happened in 2003, it wasn't tiles that were damaged, but it was this area of the reinforced carbon-carbon that was damaged when a big slab of insulating foam, lightweight insulating foam, fell off the external tank and slammed into the bottom side of the leading edge right here. In and of itself, one wouldn't have thought it could do that kind of damage, but the slab of tile was falling while the vehicle was accelerating, and so you had the combined velocities of that, and that's what made it a lethal weapon. And it broke through right here where there's a bit of an angle. You can see there are segments here, and it was segments 7 and 8 that were damaged. There was no way to see that from the vehicle. There were people on the ground who were worried that there might have been serious damage, but there was no way to prove it and no way to investigate it.
The visit to the Smithsonian's Udvar-Hazy Center provided knowledge that was taught in a way no classroom could provide, and an experience that every student valued.
My professor does a really good job at tying in space into chemistry, learning about that and actually being around it. It's really good exposure, and I can't compare it to any other class, no.
The development of the spacesuits that were used in the lab, all these are part of chemistry.
You would never think a college would have a field trip, but this is amazing. Like, not even high school they took us out here, but it's pretty cool to see that chemistry can actually be out in the real world, and it's an easy way for us students to connect with the class.